So, dear friend, today we have with us Professor Himadri Lahiri. He is a senior English professor, served long time at Bardhaman University, and after retiring from his service, he has joined at Netaji Subhash Open University. Now he is a professor of English, Department of English, Netaji Subhash Open University. And I extend my heartfelt thanks to him that he accepted our proposal for invite and invitation and consented to deliver the seventh lecture of this ongoing partition lecture series. So before I hand over the microphone to Professor Lahiri, I'd like to convey my heartfelt thanks to all of you who have come all the way to attend this lecture, and I hope you will enjoy, and his lecture will be in English. So thank you and for coming here in Netaji Subhash Open University once again. Thanks.
Thanks a lot and good afternoon everyone. It's my pleasure to be here again, and so that we can interact on a subject on which the university, this particular project, has already contributed a lot. And you see that partition studies has assumed new dimensions these days. And in this particular lecture, what I want to do is to trace the trajectory of the partition studies and the kind of reflections that have already been there on three major areas of partition. One is displacement, the other one is migration, and the third one is homeland issue. These are the three focal areas of my lecture today. And these are reflected in literary works mainly. But my focus will be more on the reflections rather than on textual studies. Okay? Because what I would like to actually interact with you on is how these studies are going on. Okay? Instead of the archaic kind of analysis, textual and otherwise, that has lost its relevance today. And as things have come to a head right now, you can see that what have been happening around us, especially on NRC and CAB, you know that the issue of partition has assumed new proportions. Its importance we have to approach from a different point of view altogether. So my vantage point is obviously 2019 and not 2000 or 2005, because every year matters in such a kind of analysis, such kind of studies, and therefore how can we approach partition studies? You know that partition actually created, the very name partition actually created, was created out of a historical position, out of a historical crisis. But interesting thing is that this crisis enveloped geography and history, two thrust areas. I will, of course, like you to remember one interesting short story written by Jhumpa Lahiri, and the title of the story is When Mr. Pirzada Came to Dine. I refer to this story and I will come back to these stories later on. What is interesting is that the focus of this particular story is 1971 civil war in Pakistan. And the place where the actions are going on is not India, is not Pakistan, but the US. So you can see the space has changed. You will have to have a different focal point. You have to have a different kind of emphasis. And I refer to this story again simply because the story is told by a very young narrator. Okay? And a young narrator who is an innocent narrator, who doesn't know much of the history and geography. Naturally, he has to dig into history. He has to dig into geography. Both geography and history are unknown to her. And naturally, the story develops in such a fashion which makes us realize the ongoing importance of the partition studies. that you will have to approach, you can approach partition studies from different angles, and diasporic angles is one of the several angles that we can take on. So you see that the main focus of all the studies, things that the crisis that generated, is actually that generated from the basic point of displacement. Because displacement was the base. Why did the people actually leave their homeland? So leaving the homeland basically puts the emphasis again on the question of the homeland, because you are no longer rooted in one place. You have to be de-rooted in order to be re-rooted. Sutrang, what actually gets importance is the question of the roots. Okay, so the basic question is, why are people displaced? There are coercive dispersals, no doubt about that. People are driven out of their villages, people are driven out of their cities, but there are many people who left out of their own volition for different reasons. For reasons of education, for reasons of advantages from the point of view of economic conditions. But people also left because there was an environment of fear and coercion. And that is what gets most importance in the studies usually. Now, along with this, there were also people were actually drawn back simply because they leaving the place also meant that they are leaving a culture. Okay, having a different kind of culture in a Bangladeshi village or an East Pakistani village and going elsewhere in search of a different culture where you will have to acclimatize is something which is a journey. And this journey is usually called migration. So migration is not just an uprootment, but it is also a rerootedness. You will have to struggle for this rerootedness, and that is where many of the writers have actually written about. That is the subject matter of many of the writers. You see that there are villages where an individual feels that it's not safe to be here. The entire community may feel like that also. A family may leave. But you may have read some of the short stories where the main question was, we are living here, if we prefer to stay here in this particular village, everybody else has left. Everybody else belonging to one particular religion has left. So for example, a Hindu character in a story, Ramesh Chandra Sen's story, says, if I prefer to stay in this village, who will offer the last water to me? Amar mrityu shumai ke jol debe. So you see, the cultural underpinning of the departures, the migrations, also there. There is a complex of reasons for which people took the decision to leave. Another important thing in the partition narratives, you will find the ways of means of the leaving, the migration. You see, there are people who left by aeroplane. There are people who for example, the Sindhi people, who actually left parts of Pakistan through ships. Okay, there was obviously train. Train is a major metaphor in the partition studies, partition literature. But most of these people, they either left on bullock carts or on foot. Okay, so the different kinds of leaving, the different transport mediums, they convey different kind of significations. And I say this particularly because these underpins the class nature, the nature of the class that the people actually belong to. The people who left by aeroplane or ship, they could pay their passage. But the other people, they could not pay the passage. And the people who left on foot, that is the most important area for us to study, simply because it took a long time and it went through different kinds of trial and tribulations, different kind of sufferings, the varieties of sufferings, the varieties of encounters, the varieties of experiences that living by aeroplane or living by ships couldn't produce. So the modes of transport is not only important from the class point of view, it is also important for us to unfold, because these unfold the human dimensions, which you couldn't trace in the stories or in the narratives of departure, the migration, which doesn't tell us much about the sufferings of the people. So, on the one hand, the class and caste angles are there, and this is actually best brought out through narratives, which are actually represented, the narratives are represented through fictional fictions, which speaks of the journeys. And therefore, the mode of journey, I believe, is a very important area where we can focus. There were actually, long lines of processions, okay? For example, U. Bhaskar Rao, he wrote a book called The Story of Rehabilitation, okay? There, he says that there are sometimes you could see people, caravan of people, okay, procession of people, as long as 240 kilometers with 50,000 to 60,000 refugees. You can imagine the kind of procession that it was, these were, because they were living often under state directions that they should not isolate themselves from the procession. They should go together, okay? And for the reasons of the safety also, they wanted to hold together so that they do not become victims. That did not happen always in case of train journeys. Okay, trains had to go through areas where they ran through majority of people. They might be Hindus, they might be Muslims, they might be Sikhs, and it is because of this that the trains were the targets of attacks. I also have included the homeland issues simply because the homeland issue, I think, is the most crucial issue. It is a cultural issue as well. It is not only a matter of geography, but it is also a very much a cultural issue. Because you see that it involves a kind of imagined homeland. Think of the refugees who went to Andaman Islands, for example. They were Bengali Hindus. Most of them belong to the lower class. Okay, they mostly belong to the Motua community. So what happened when they went there? Because process of selection of refugees who would be transported there was done in a very careful fashion. Each family, all the members of the family had to undergo scrutiny, whether they are healthy, whether they can withstand the kinds of sufferings they will have to undergo there, because they will have to clear the land and make settlements. Therefore, there are many diseases there waiting for them, and therefore they will have to be very strong. So the state measures were fashioned in such a way that they must be very strong. And when they went there, what happened is that they also had to cohabit with other groups of people who are also there. And they will have to carve out a homeland there. And that cannot be homeland geographically re-established. That will have to be a homeland which will be culturally re-established. So they arranged songs, for example, weekly songs. They arranged different kinds of functions there, which they used to resort to in their homeland back in what is called Bangladesh right now. And moreover, what is more important to my mind is that they had to plant trees. They had to plant shupari tree, for example, okay, and flora and fauna, which will be similar to those of the original homeland. So the homeland is being carved out there, and this homeland is made in the image of the original homeland, but then the two homelands cannot be the same. So what happens that there are different dimensions of this homemaking, there are deviations from the original homeland, and therefore what happens is that the new people who are there, who are strangers there, people who belong to other communities, what happened is that they were also invited here, but they came here as strangers, but then this difference made the community feel homogeneous. Okay, so they attempted to create a homogeneous homeland and homogeneous community in the Andaman Islands. That is one example. Why did I give the example of the Andaman? I give this example simply because our studies are mostly one-dimensional studies. The kind of studies that is being pursued in the mainstream academia usually is one-dimensional studies. So recently, we are opening up the borders. The borders of the countries, border of the partition studies, and that includes spatial dimensions. Where are the new homelands created? One might be the Andaman. So we may search for narratives coming out of the Andaman Islands, autobiographical narratives or fictional narratives or things like that. So there are other dimensions also, spatial dimensions. I will come to that later on. But then my point is that the recreation of the homeland in the new spaces follow the patterns of the original, supposed to be the originary homeland back in East Pakistan. And the markers are very important, and these markers includes flora and fauna, which seems to be very important dimensions. What are the trees that you plant there? What are the animals that you take along with you? Okay, these are important for your recreation of the space. When you reroute yourself in the new homeland or new home, what happens is that there is nostalgia. But please remember that nostalgia is something which is very, very specific to the first generation. The intermediate generation, the second generation, carries on the nostalgia of the forefathers or foremothers. But along with that, the third generation, I believe that is the generation where things are changing, the trajectory is changing, where these people do not have any direct connection with the home, supposedly originary home, that is back in a different geography. That is in a different geography simply because you cannot go to that geography. You cannot go back, because if you want to go back to the geography, you will have to cross the border, and crossing the border means you will have to have passports and visas and all the official procedures. Okay? And moreover, there might be tensions, communal tensions. You want to go back to your home village, for example. Why have you come back to the village? You will have to explain that, because there are threat perceptions. You may be accepted as a guest, but that does not tell the whole story, because you are a guest, you are given all kinds of welcome, because there is a strong belief that you are not going to claim your land, and you are not going to claim any place in history, the past history. Therefore, what happens is that you are taken in very, very friendly. But there are cases. I have my friends who went to different places in Bangladesh. There were questions about their intentions. Why have you come back? Especially, these people were very much cautious about the new guests. Why the coming back after 40 years, 50 years, 60 years? So coming back is fraught with immense significance. But then this is part of the nostalgia also. Okay, this is a nostalgia which the first generation go through, and they take mati, earth. There are families which has taken some amount of mati, which and they have carried along all along their lives. Okay, that is something which is very significant. Significant in the sense of that this mati is symbolic. Okay, and through this symbol, you reach out to the other land, other geography, other history. The history that you cannot access right now except through your nostalgia. So nostalgia is a medium of sustenance. Okay, a sustenance which makes you live, which makes your living meaningful, because you are in an in-between stage. You have accepted that you cannot go back, but you have also accepted that you can stay here. Okay? And this mati is important because this mati is also transplanted in the new mati, suggesting that the two matis get merged and these two earths become one earth. Okay? So this symbolic act is considered to be very important for the first generation people. And you see, the mati is, I think, when it is uttered in Bengali or in Assamese, what happens, it takes on extensive meaning, meaning that you can extend on. In Assamese, for in Bengal, we call it jomi, land. But in Assam, you will find they will call mati. So there are nuances in the word mati. Okay? And just yesterday, I suppose, or the day before yesterday, Shankha Ghosh has written a poem called Mati. Okay, I will come back to the poem, and that is why I said that I am approaching this problem from the vantage point of 2019, not from 2005 or 2000. Okay, what does this Mati signify, and why is it that Shankha Ghosh actually invokes the image of the mati? Now, you see that I refer to the generation question, because along with the generations, the significance of the words like home and the homeland changes. Okay? The third generation want to move along. They, without any history, without any memory, without any direct involvement, they move on and want to create a different kind of dimension of relationships. Okay? But the poems or the narratives, the fictional narratives that we come across, they are mostly products of the first generation of refugees or the second generation of refugees. We are not very sure what the third generation people will produce on the line. What will be their dimension? We are not very certain about that. Urvashi Bhutalia's latest book, which is on the Long Shadows of Partition, that deals with this particular question. That deals with, it has two main foci. And what are these foci? Number one is the third generation, and number two is the areas on which partition studies have not been done. Okay? For example, in Ladakh, it tells of a story that speaks of the Ladakh region. Okay, how did the Ladakhi region, for example, took the partition narratives? What were their dimensions? Did they have that kind of a nostalgia? So you see, the partition studies is moving along different directions. I will come to some of these directions, so that we can have some kind of history about the trajectories. Now, talking about the generation, as you see, there is much ambiguity about the homeland. We have read about the shadow lines. Okay, Amitabh Ghosh's book, that is a tremendous book. Okay, Shadow Lines. You see that he writes from a standpoint that will have to be evaluated by us. He is a person who is basically a transnational person, okay, who is not located in one single place, who is not located in West Bengal. He has his house in Goa, for example, but he has his house in California also. So he is a global traveler. How will he see this partition? Obviously, his angle will be different. And the very title, Shadow Lines, you will remember that it is taken from a short story written by Joseph Conrad. Okay. And he actually reworked with the title, adding the and lines. He didn't add the, it was originally in the short story. He said shadow lines. The plurality of the lines is important here. He is dealing with not only geographical lines, but he is also dealing with metaphorical lines, because it is a family saga. So on the one hand, there is the partition. It is not exactly a partition story. It is a reflection of the partition. It is an it talks about the afterlife of the partition more than it is on partition. Okay, so in the afterlife, you are shown that not only the land is divided, but also the family is divided. What is the significance, for example, of the title Shadow Lines? Number one is plurality of the lines. Secondly, when is the shadow line created? It is created only when there is one point of source of focus, light, for example, okay, and when there is an object. So the object lies in between, okay, and the light is from there. So this light is the light of the consciousness, okay. We think, how we perceive the things. This perception is the kind of a consciousness which falls on an object. And what is the object? Our mentality, our mindset. Okay? How do we see the partition? Partition is in the mind. Okay? We partition people in our minds because we stereotype. Simply because we stereotype, the shadows are created. We have to cross those lines. So it is a story about transcendence of the shadow lines. Okay? The geographical lines is not that important. And that is why he refers to the image of map. Map is again a constructed thing. A thing which is constructed. Which is cartographer construct the maps. Okay? And this construction is important because this is done along the nation states. I will like to draw your attention to two concepts. One is nation and the other one is nation state. I believe that nation is basically a cultural concept, while nation state is a political concept. Okay, nation state has geographical materiality. So in Shadow Lines, these two concepts merge and they conflict each other. Okay? And there are contradictions between these two concepts. One is the nation concept, other one is the nation state concept. How do you conceive your nation? Whom do you include? Whom do you exclude? What happens when you include these things? These are the questions that are being reflected on right now. Okay, when the CAB and the RSE, these are being debated on. Okay, so this is a question of constructions. Now, there is a character called Thamma, Takuma, endearingly called Thamma, because here also the narrator is a young narrator, unnamed narrator. Amitabh Ghosh has preferred to keep the narrator unnamed, anonymous. Okay, and he is a curious being. Why an unnamed narrator, young narrator, young boy narrator? In the partition stories, you will come across boy narrators, girl narrators, all innocent beings. Okay, why is it so? Because these are the young boys and girls who can see things uncensored. They do not censor. They are not guided by the commonsensical things because they are yet to develop the common sense, what we call common sense. Okay, so they actually take cognizance of the smallest details. Ice Candy Man is one such example where there is young narrator, girl narrator. Okay, and when Mr. Pirzada came to dine, is told from the perspective of a young girl narrator, 10-year-old Lilia. Okay, here also there is a young boy narrator who talks about what is happening all around him, and he tells everything uncensored. Okay, and he puts questions which are important. He puts several questions to Thamma. Okay, because Thamma, he is pushed between two personalities. One personality is Thamma, who is driven out from, who was forced to come out from Dhaka, Jindbahal Lane, a very geographic specificity has been given, and she was willing to visit that, revisit that, and you know what happened to that Tridib diet. As a result of the visit, it was a chaotic situation at that time, and as a result of communal frenzy, Tridib, who is very much in the family, he died. Okay? You see, this young boy narrator is placed in between Thamma, who is a divided self, a split self, and Tridib, who is a second generation, third generation person, who doesn't believe in that kind of psychology. So Thamma is haunted by nostalgia. Tridib sees everything objectively and puts question. You see, the boy narrator wants to grasp the significance of what is going on. Thamma says one thing, but Tridib, who is an iconic figure for him, he says something else. Tridib is a globetrotter, not always physically, but mentally. So the position is that of a transnational human being. Okay, transnational subject who believes, who does not believe in shadow lines, who wants to approach the partition from a different point of view altogether. So this can only be taken by somebody who perhaps does not have any history of partition in his blood, direct blood. Directly, he doesn't have that kind of a... So, the transnational aspect is another, yet another aspect from which we can move, we can study the partition narratives. Now, you see that Ramesh Chandra Sen's A Thorn in the Path, the Bengali, original Bengali was Pother Kanta. Many of you have read the story. I will talk a bit about that simply because you can position it in the period, okay, during the period of the actual migration, okay. And I will talk about when Mr. Pirzada came to dine, which talks from the point of view, a temporal point of view of 1971, okay, when Bangladesh, the Bangladesh was created, okay. On the eve of that creation of the Bangladesh, the young girl narrator Lilia sees everything, tries to negotiate meanings about them, and he therefore gives a kind of a narrative. Okay, these two narratives are posited in two different points of time, and therefore they actually offer different kind of trajectories. That is what I want to drive home in this lecture. You see that Ramesh Sen's Chandra Sen's novel is about, short story is about actual migration. And this is journey on foot. And there is a procession of families. All the families are going together. It is a narrative of encounter with others. Who are the others? The story speaks of answers. A-N-S-A-R-S. answers. I do not know the exact pronunciation of the word answer. This is an Arabic word which was used in East Pakistan or West Pakistan at that time. They were often state-supported, self-styled groups which attacked the Hindu refugees who were on their way to West Bengal, okay, or to Punjab. So this answers originally, actually, at this Arabic word actually meant helpers in Medina, Makkah and Medina, because they used to help Muhammad. Okay? And but that changed meaning over the years, and that was used in a different context there. But this Shen's story actually talks about the Hindu family's encounter with the answers on the one hand, or on the other hand, with another group of refugees coming from West Bengal to Bangladesh, East Pakistan, and then at that time it was East Pakistan. So this is on the one hand the narrative of actual migration. Secondly, it is a narrative of encounter with others. Number three, it is a narrative of how the refugees went beyond their religious affiliations and empathetically they looked forward for union with the helpless people all over the Indian subcontinent. So there, it is also a narrative of transcendence of the refugees from being Hindu refugees to being refugees of all colors and creeds. So from these three points, the third one is obviously an ethical point. It is about the goodness. It is about the hospitality. It is about how to mix with other people and make the others part of the self. So from these three points of view, this is very important. Now, if you look, these are the two stories that I have in mind. But let me have just a look at how the partition literature, how the discourses on partition literature actually moved. You will find that initially, partition literature was all about humanitarianism. Okay, the basic focus was the humanitarian values, which is also encoded in Shen's story, Pother Kanta, that it is encoded there. You see that the next step, from mainly 1980s and 1990s, partition studies tried to focus on deconstructive and very specific points. Okay. What do I mean by that? I mean that it is the period, especially 1990s, when feminist narratives and feminist discourses began to be born. It is also a time in later decades, subaltern points of view were focused on. Then class and caste angles, urban, rural divide, mainstream, alternative, for example, oral historiography, all these became important from 1990s onwards. And the third points that are being actually focused on these days are spatial points of view. Actually, the critics and the discourses looked at different spatial points, for example, camps, okay, camp literature, for example, enclave literature, that is more recently, it is being done, diasporic literature, where is the narration taking place, that became very important. The second story that I am referring to, when Mr. Pirzada came to dine, is one example of that diasporic perspective. Okay? And fourth is obviously generation narratives, discourses and narratives, literary and otherwise, which focus basically on retrieval. Okay, there are retrieval narratives. Third, fourth generation people, the granddaughters, grandsons, they are trying to retrieve the stories of their grandmothers or things like that. So these are the different focal points which have come up to this point. And the trajectory is still moving on. We do not know what angles they will take from here. Let me focus for some time on Ramesh Chandra Sen's story. As I said, there are three or four angles here. You see, the Pother Kanta, this metaphor is very important in the story because that moves the story. The story is taken forward by this metaphor. Who is Pother Kanta? Initially, it's a narration of a journey of a family towards West Bengal. The young child, there are basically three characters. Parashar is the father figure. Parashar is actually complaining because his son, who is very young, who cannot move as fast as the others. So he was very afraid because the answers might come and loot them. So they must move forward. So he says that you are not moving forward and therefore all of us will die. These are the words that Parashar says about his son. Will I have to die because of you, rascal? Then the child was suffering. He was running fever. And the father figure is reacting. Let him be burning with fever. Let it turn to ashes. You see what kind of non-humanitarian approach, it apparently is non-humanitarian. Then he again says, I know he will be the cause of my death. What with the answers threatening to arrive any moment now? What do these comments actually suggest? These comments basically point to the fear psychosis. These comments actually point towards, gesture towards the existence of others who are threatening others, who will come and destroy the self physically and culturally. Because there are human bodies which can be polluted. Okay, not only your material wealth, but also bodies are important here because bodies are embodiment of cultural values. And therefore, you are going not only to be losing your property, but you might be going to be ravaged physically. And therefore, the keeping your identity intact is also on the mind of the patriarchal figure of the family, okay, Parashar. And therefore, that is the basic focus of point and the title takes its root from here. But towards the end of the novel, there is a turn there. They were taking a rest near a lake where many people have already died infected by cholera. Okay, there, Parashar found a young baby suckling his mother and crying. And therefore, this patriarchal figure who was rebuking his son, out of compassion, he takes the baby to his, embraces him and takes the baby back to the family. So how would you comment on this? How would you conceive this? Because it was hard time, because it was a time when the survival of the self was most important, and this character whom we have found rebuking his family is taking pity on a young baby and taking him into the family. It amounts to the extending the family circle. Okay, the family is not only the blood relationship, the members who have blood relationships, but it is also extended to someone who may not have blood relationships. So there is a kind of community affiliation in the story. So from that point of view, I believe that these are comments on the ethical attitude even in the midst of ruins. Now, you see, the mother figure who was angry with the father figure, because the father figure actually was rebuking the son. When the father figure came back, Parashur came back with the baby, the mother figure became very furious. Why? Because we cannot feed these three people. There is an extra mouth to feed, and he is infected with poison, cholera, and the entire family may be destroyed. And she reacts in a furious way. But then Parashar threatens, if you have that kind of attitude, what I will do, I will leave behind all the pather katas, all the thorns, which include his wife, his own son, and even the baby. So the concept of the kata, the concept of the thorn, is expanded to include a community affiliation. So it is a story not only about a family, not only about a community, it is a story about transcendence. Transcendence of the boundary, because the kind of shadow lines that have encircled the story so far in the beginning, that must be expanded. There is another angle to the story. You see that the answers, the threatening other, is a constant reference point. It is present all throughout the story, right from the beginning to the end. Answers are the people who are others, but the refugees who are coming from West Bengal, they are also supposed to be others. So they suddenly come across a group of people who are coming from another dimension, from the West Bengal side. They were moving westward. So this procession was moving eastward, and that procession was moving westward, and they met at one certain point. And there was Allahu Akbar chantings over there when they were at distance. When they came together and stopped at one point, met at one point, one group looked at the other group, and Parashar could find clear sympathy in the eyes of the others. Okay, and the same kind of sympathy they could feel in the eyes of the same group as well. So, at another angle, the other is turned into self. And from that point of view, what is suggested, that the refugees form one group and don't try to divide shadow lines among the groups. So, the story, although very short, but then have immense dimensions from the point of view of the shadow lines that exist between us. The shadow lines actually operates at different levels, okay? And these shadow lines should be erased. That is basically the message of the short story. But it has different dimensions, and therefore I have chosen this. But it also it can be utilized, the studies, the partition studies, simply because you see, it also speaks of the reverse migration, from migration from the other side. It is not only a migration from East Pakistan to West Bengal, but it is also a narrative, in a certain sense, procession of people from West Bengal to East Pakistan. So, although very short in span, although very short in size, the story can be read from different angles. Then I will try to move on to the next story, which is Jhumpa Lahiri's When Mr. Pirzada Came to Dine. Now, we have the 1947 perspective in the earlier story, which is basically a humanitarian story, a story of ethics, ethical values. Now, this is another story which is also interspersed with ethical values. But the background of the story is the diaspora, the US. What happens there? Mr. Pirzada, who is an East Pakistani, US campus, university campus, for 9 months on a grant. At that time, in his homeland, the civil war was raging. Pakistani army was attacking the East Pakistani freedom fighters, and the struggle was going on. From one point of view, it is more a story of partition, or story of 1971. But it is not a separate story, because the characters who are there, who bind 1947 with 1971. Who are the characters? Lilia, a 10-year-old girl, her parents, who have extended hospitality to Mr. Pirzada, because Mr. Pirzada, who came from East Pakistan, does not have a television set in his room. It was 1970s. Although there was television set, but it was a bit rare. So, the Lilia's family had a television set. Why is television set important here? Television was telecasting the news of the 1970 war freedom struggle. And there were three characters, Mr. Pirzada and the parents of Lilia. Okay, Lilia is standing at a distance and observing the three characters. They are three bodies belonging to two nations, India and Pakistan, but they have become one body. Because they, to the young narrator, these three characters have become one. Culturally speaking, from behavioral point, they have become one, and all of them are anxious about what is happening in Dhaka. The spelling is D-A-C-C-A. What is happening in Dhaka? Okay. So Dhaka is the anglicized Dhaka, and it is the spelling of the East Pakistan. Okay. So time reference is there. So the Lilia from a distance is looking at three characters, and three characters to her is one, because they follow similar kinds of cultural habits. But Lilia feels that they are Indians. Although her father says that Mr. Pirzada is not Indian, with an emphasis on not. There are some words I will just quote from here, but this is important here, because the Lilia's parents are the products of 1947 partition, and Mr. Pirzada is directly related to 1971 struggle. He is a figure through which 1971 is approached. So 1947 and 1971 becomes a long partition. Okay, so it becomes a long shadow, something that critics like Jahanara Begum, Ananya Jahanara speaks of. Okay, there are many critics who speaks of many partitions, but the many partitions are the product of one single partition, which is 1947 partition, not so much the 1905 partition. You see that this looking at this perspective is significant, because the young girl wants to reconfigure the question of homeland from the perspective of a diasporic third generation narrator. So the two identity questions, tags are there. Number one, diasporic, and number two, third generation. Okay, these two, therefore he has to do reconfigure the history and the geography. It speaks of multiple belongings because they belong to many places and they speak of post-colony. Okay, there is no longer the British imperialism. India and Pakistan have become post-colony and managing their own affairs, but despite the indigenous management of the state affairs, there have been many Pakistans and there are possibilities of many Indias. Okay, kitne Pakistans and kitne Indias. Okay, there are always the possibilities of that. So multiple belongings and the question of homeland is very much there, and all these things take place in the post-colony. Post-colony is a very important concept these days because it is an afterwardness of colonialism. Okay, so it is part of post-colonialism, but post-colonialism has taken a different shape altogether, taken a different trajectory these days. Now, since I do not have much time, I will try to focus on certain points, very focal points. I would quote a few lines from when Mr. Pirzada came to dine. One is the voice of the narrator. I was 10 years old and was not surprised that my parents, who were from India, so she is not thinking herself as an Indian in a sense, because she belongs to a different generation and she is having a different training in educational and social institution of America. So he says that my parents are from India, and she does not include herself in the family when this question of affiliation, national affiliation, comes. My parents, who were from India and had a number of Indian acquaintances at the university, should ask Mr. Pirzada to share our meals. So the kitchen, the kitchen table becomes the meeting point where the three bodies become one body. And then another short quotation, what is it, Lilia? Lilia answers, a glass for the Indian man, referring to Mr. Pirzada. Mr. Pirzada won't be coming today, she says. More importantly, Mr. Pirzada is no longer considered Indian. So the young girl has to reconfigure the meaning of Indianness. Okay, not only so, she is aware of her American position, she is aware of her Indian lineage of her parents, but she is not aware of a third party, who is Mr. Pirzada, who seems to have a different identity, national identity altogether. So what is that identity? She has to figure out, although there is sameness. There are not much differences. Okay, so the story actually moves along the same different binary, but transcends the same different binary, sameness and self binary. It transcends that binary. Not since partition, our country was divided. So this is a new information for the young child. Then another quotation, it made no sense to me. Mr. Pirzada and my parents spoke the same language, laughed at the same jokes, looked more or less the same. They ate pickled mangoes with their meals, ate rice every night for supper with their hands. Like my parents, Mr. Pirzada took off his shoes before entering a room, chewed fennel seeds after meals as a digestive, drank no alcohol. For dessert, dipped austere biscuits into successive cups of tea. Nevertheless, my father insisted that I understand the difference, and he led me to a map of the world taped to the wall over his desk. So you see, the entire quotation, the small quotation, actually revolves around the sameness difference binary. Okay, Mr. Pirzada appears to be same, but his father says that he is not same. He is different. So how can I perceive this difference? That is that question is foregrounded in the story. So there is a play on sameness difference binary, and there is an emphasis on the transcending of the binary. The same kind of emphasis on transcendence that we have found in the Shadow Lines, Amitabh Ghosh's story, and also in the two stories that I have just cited. So on the whole, literary representations are saner representations. These are different because there is a mediation of literature. There is a mediation of time and word. Okay, you as an individual, you can work upon your experiences. And there is a belatedness. There is a different distance from what happened earlier, what you have heard, and how you have perceived that experience over the time. So this time has helped you mediate between what happened actually and what might happen in future, and what you are writing, keeping the future in mind. So these writings are basically futuristic. Although they talk about the past, they talk about history, they talk about the present time, but they are basically futuristic in dimensions. They have their gestures which are pointed towards future. So from that point of view, this is, I believe, a very important kind of a story that we can think. Now, since we have almost arrived at the last moments of my lecture, I will just mention Shankha Ghosh's poem that was circulated widely in the Facebook yesterday, and I have tried to link it up with the narratives that have gone before, with the play of sameness versus difference binary. You belong to a different religion, so you are different. I belong to a same different religion, so I am the same. I am approaching in the nation state, I am approaching this question, and therefore what happens, that nation state steps in. Okay, in this play of binaries, what happens, the nation state actually steps in to create further differences between us. That is where this poem, short poem, Mati, actually intervenes. Mati, as I said, is symbolic in nature. Mati, as I said, basically signifies rootedness. And therefore, and Mati, as I said, as the Assamese people would say, Mati means land. Okay, Mati is not just symbolic, it is also land. So Mati becomes the title of the poem, and it is very difficult to translate it. You can do it earth, but earth may not convey the entire meaning of Mati. Okay, you cannot do it like soil, that too will be inadequate. I am not going into that, but I have tried to translate a few lines from there. The poem begins with certain geocultural symbols, like some, and you see flora and fauna. For example, he mentions a particular flower, Gandharaj, for example. Okay, he mentions Ajoy Nodi, and the basic point is that I have grown up with all these things as internal to me. They are nothing external. This is part of my extended self. So there has been a kind of an interlink between the self and the geophysical, geocultural terrain. And after saying that, it comes to the main point in view of the CAB or RAC or things like that. And I have translated like this. Look around and see, all the bridges stand collapsed. If you ask me to leave, where shall I go now? This is the main question here. Dudike takhiye dekho, bhenge ache shobgulo shako. Kunkhane jabo ar, jodi aaj chole jete bolo. This is the Bengali lines. Then comes these lines. Godhuli rongin macha, oparai uteche ajan. এ দাওয়ায় বসে ভাবি দুনিয়া আমার মেহমান, এখনো পরীক্ষা চায় আগুন সমাজ, এ মাটি আমারও মাটি, সে কথা সবার সামনে কিভাবে প্রমাণ করব আজ? দ্য ব্যাম্বু সিটস ইন দ্য ফেডিং ইভিনিং লাইট, ইটস টাইম ফর আজান অন দ্যাট সাইড অব দ্য নেইবারহুড, সিটিং ইন দ্য পোর্টিকো দিস সাইড, দ্য ওয়ার্ল্ড ইজ মাই গেস্ট. This fierce society still demands my scrutiny. This earth is my world too. How to prove that today? That is how I have translated, but there are inadequacies. I will try to work upon it. But the message is very clear. So the poet has come down to Mati. The poet cannot actually keep his separate self. Okay? The poet has to come down to the ground and participate in the struggle. That is what perhaps Shankha Ghosh wants to drive home. This is the point that we should take care of. Thank you very much.